last 2 years have seen a massive spike in the amount of recalled automobiles, and there doesn't appear to be any sign of that slowing down. Recently, manufacturers began recalling millions of vehicles for a faulty airbag design, and I have attorney David Haynes with me now to discuss that recall, as well as the growing problem of auto safety. David, one of the biggest recalls happening right now, it's been in the headlines all over the place, are the Takata airbags. You and I, many, many months ago, had talked about this issue a little bit, but now this recall is really picking up steam. Take us back in time a little bit, you know, from the start. What is the problem with these Takata airbags?
And that's one of the most frustrating things, Farron. We were discussing this over 7 months ago, and the need for a wider recall. And in fact, back all the way back to 2008 is when Honda first recalled these airbags, and Takata now is only beginning to take full responsibility. So the overview is that Takata is a Japanese company which uses ammonium nitrate in their airbags, and that's a certain type of propellant that when the airbag actually deploys it, it creates the explosion that deploys the airbag into the cabin. The problem is that ammonium nitrate is a bit unstable, and particularly in humid environments like the southeastern United States, over a period of years, it can begin to degrade and become destable. And when the airbag deploys after a crash, the airbag actually will deploy with way too much force, and that force will also cause metal shards from the airbag in the vehicle to then hit the face and the torso of the occupant, severely injuring them, and in six cases at least that we know of have caused death. So this is an extremely serious situation.
So six people have actually died as a result of an airbag that is designed to save their lives. And so, you know, taking it back again to the very beginning, was Takata aware that this could happen with their airbags when they sent them to market?
Absolutely. This has been another situation of a large automaker, a large corporation putting their head in the sand, deny the scope and scale of the problem because they're concerned about their stock price and they're concerned about their financial health of the executives, and they're not concerned about the safety of those people that are driving in the vehicles and riding in their vehicles. I mean, Honda is, you know, did a huge recall, a significant recall over 8 years ago with the same problem. So Takata has known, and by the way, where has the government been in all of this? I mean, NHTSA is now saying they've got control of it. Well, you know, after this many years, they're finally supposedly getting control of it. And incidentally, the Takata executives were on the Hill this week testifying that they're still going to use ammonium nitrate in these airbags. They flip-flopped on that, and now the testimony is that they're still going to use it in certain situations. And in fact, they're putting it in the replacement airbags when their competitors are not using ammonium nitrate. And clearly, it appears that, you know, this is not a stable compound that can be used, yet they're in total denial. So the Takata financial health of the company obviously now is tanking. The recall is up to 53 million cars worldwide. That's 34 million cars in the United States that have these airbags. And so it's a situation where a lot of these injuries and deaths could have and should have been prevented if Takata would have done the right thing and if our federal regulators would have had more teeth and implemented a stronger recall program.
So Takata went to Washington to address the issue, and they said, okay, look, here's the problem. It's the ammonium nitrate, but we're still going to do this? That's what they told these federal regulators in Washington?
Yeah, it was a lot of evasive testimony. Congressman Kennedy and others were pressing the executives on this issue, and they're claiming that they believe that ammonium nitrate, when properly phased in and stabilized, still can be effectively used. So this is something that the government should look at and determine whether or not it should be prohibited from Takata using this. It's a huge logistical challenge just to get 34 million airbags switched out in the states, as well as worldwide. It probably is the most complicated and largest recall of any automotive component in the history of this country. And so that appears to be one of the reasons that they're continuing to stick with ammonium nitrate, even in the replacement bags, because otherwise it would just take too long and there's not enough production supply, either with Takata switching over or filling the void with some of the other competitors. And so serious questions are being raised about whether or not the fix for the recall is really even a complete fix, or whether there's going to continue to be significant risk on the roadway for those of you who think you're being protected by a safety feature that you're paying for in your vehicle, when in fact that feature is going to maim you with metal shards and can even result in death from, you know, a somewhat serious but otherwise would not be a fatal injury from a serious fender bender, for example. But the airbag, in fact, does more damage than the other vehicle.
And, you know, you kind of just touched on this a minute ago. You mentioned that, you know, the federal government says, okay, look, we've got this under control. We're trying to fix the problem. I've read a lot of stories over the last couple months that actually discuss the problem of the overall auto recall system in the United States, which currently is a mix of both the private industry and the federal government. If the federal government were to possibly kind of take the reins a little bit more, take it out of the hands of corporations, just in your personal opinion, do you think we might get a better system in place if we took it away from private industry and let the government be in charge? Or do you think the system is working as it is?
Well, you're raising very, very valid questions about federal oversight and the revolving door that we're seeing in a lot of the government agencies. It's big business is getting their teeth in there. And we see this in the FDA situation with Big Pharma. And we're also seeing it in the federal government oversight. And absolutely, it should be a completely independent authority, which is not beholden to large corporations and funding from the big three automakers and others, where we have a revolving door from executives coming and going out of the government and back to, you know, it's like the fox watching the hen house, essentially. We, you know, NHTSA has been too slow. They're waiting for Takata to take responsibility and say, well, now they're finally taking responsibility. Well, with all due respect, we've known for years this has been a problem. Why were these vehicles still on the road? Why was Takata still allowed to continue to deny? And it's similar to some of the problems we've seen with the GM ignition defect that we've talked about on your program as well. And, you know, that the consumers are the loser here, and our government is responsible for protecting the community. We're talking about something like a dollar or two maybe for the a coil that had a little bit better strength. The coil was too weak. And if a lot of people had heavy keychains, it's in a lot of the compact vehicles, if your knee hit the ignition switch, the coil was not strong enough. It was an extremely, you know, maybe pennies or a dollar or two. And, you know, dozens and dozens killed, many other others injured and maimed. And just heart goes out to the families who've lost a loved one. What was clearly a preventable situation.
Absolutely. And it's beyond infuriating to think. And it's the same thing with the Ford Pinto. With that, I believe it was about an $8 part that would have prevented the car from exploding upon rear impact. And it's the same thing with GM. You know, worst case scenario, $5 extra per car could have saved lives. Families are missing children, missing mothers, missing fathers, because the company wanted to save a handful of dollars. I mean, enough to go buy a soda from a vending machine. That's, to me, that's the corporate mentality of how little they value human life. I mean, we're worth a Coke. That's what we're worth to them.
Yeah, a very sad situation when risk analysis is done in this situation, like in the Pinto, as far as what it would cost to fix out all the vehicles versus what the claims would cost to be paid. That's a terrible chapter in automotive history. We need to be moving past that. But when you see situations like this, you know, the executives and general counsel is now, I believe, resigned, claiming they didn't have knowledge of this situation. The engineers were covering up. But even if that's the case, clearly you have a culture where we're not promoting, you know, safety at all costs in the community and among these big automakers. And the government needs to be playing a stronger role, because it seems like they're very late to the party and they're not being more proactive in these situations and looking out for the public. Why so long in the Takata airbag, NHTSA? You know, why so long? Now, you know, 34 million cars have been recalled. If your viewers are concerned whether their vehicle is on the list, they can go to NHTSA.org. That's NHTSA.org. Enter the VIN number in their vehicle and see if their vehicle is subject to any recalls and try to take appropriate action.
David Haynes, Washington, D.C., the Cochran Firm. Thank you so much for telling this story, and keep on it. We will check back in with you very soon.
Thank you, Farron.